Good morning, everyone. Pete Pardo here from Sea of Tranquility. Welcome to another edition of Friday Morning at the Fun House, or Friday Morning Apocalypse, whatever you want to call it, with Martin Popoff and Pete Pardo. Today, we've got an interesting little topic, another recommendation from a couple of our viewers. A lot of people ask us, well, Pete, what about like a discussion about greatest hit sets and which bands have the greatest hit sets? Well, Martin and I were talking about it, and we said, well, how about we do a little twist on this? Instead of like who has the greatest hit set, the greatest best of sets, how about those bands where, you know what, that greatest hit set maybe is all you need, right? Because we get a lot of people talking when we do these like album rankings and song rankings and things like that. And they're like, you know what? I only like their hits. The greatest hit set is all I need. I don't need to go buying all the albums and so on and so forth. So we started talking and we're like, well, you know what? There are some bands that we both think, you know what, the greatest hit set probably has their best songs, or maybe not, right? So today, Martin and I have each picked five bands where we don't may or may not necessarily just own that greatest hit set. In most of mine, I have all the albums, but when I recollect back on them, I'm like, yeah, I got all these albums. But you know what? If someone said, Pete, we're sending you off to a desert island, and you can only have one album from this band, which one would you take? I'd probably be like, give me the greatest hit set, because that's pretty damn good. So I'm going to have Martin, if you want to give a little commentary there before you lead in with your first choice of the day.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I agree with most of what you said there. And I took it a little more of a twist over to the idea of, so the first thing is when you brought up this idea, you know, the idea was, almost like you're a casual fan of this band and the greatest hits is enough. And I started going through the bands and thinking, do I even have any of those? Like, it's really hard to think of those where the greatest hits would be the only thing I wanted. And I typically went down the road of Bruce Springsteen and Tom Petty and Billy Joel and even the Eagles and that. And I'm going through it in my mind and thinking, it's not really lining up properly. So I went a little more of the way of, as you mentioned, the idea of I have all these albums, but the hits are my favorite songs of them. And so it's a little more in that direction where I love these bands, but I'm lining up, i.e. not being a contrarian. I'm lining up with what the label brass thinks should be a hit, what went on the greatest hits package, what is the opening track of a lot of these albums, right? And the live favorites kind of thing. So that's kind of the way I looked at this. And I realized that all five of my examples kind of fall more in that rather than I'm only a casual fan of these bands. So that's kind of what happened with my list. So my first one is Pantera. There's a greatest hits album from Pantera.
And I will say that is a great greatest hits set.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And there's Vulgar. So true. I mean, the reason I had to pick Pantera is they're one of these bands where, you know, Dimebag, I love the riffs he writes, but I find him to be very noisy. I find, like when he solos and wants to be atmospheric, I don't think this band is particularly good at thrash. So when they thrash out, it's almost like they're just trying to be chaotic and noisy and aggressive. I love this whole idea, you know, and people really put this down because it comes a little bit from nu metal, this idea. Well, actually Pantera predates nu metal and it came from Pantera into nu metal, this idea of groove metal, right? So my favorite Pantera stuff is when they're being really, really groovy. And to really drive home the point that this is the greatest hits band for me, first track on the first major label album, Cowboys from Hell, and first track on the second, the most beloved Pantera album, Vulgar Display of Power, Mouth for War, are probably my two favorite Pantera songs. They're the two big epic. They're the most popular songs. They're the hits. You know, there's videos. But, you know, when I look at this and I see Cemetery Gates, Walk, This Love, I'm Broken, literally the first six tracks are some of, you know, literally my favorite Pantera songs. I don't even mind when this band does the novelty thing and does a cover. But 5 minutes Alone, groovy. I like the big choruses, the songs, the staying away from the noise, the hooks, and the grooviness. And, you know, frankly, I guess I like the most accessible commercial stuff that Pantera does over and above when they're being really crazy extreme. So there you go. My number five, Pantera.
That's a great pick. And I want to expand on that a little bit. So when Pantera was first like hitting it big, I went and picked up, their first couple. I mean, I'm not talking about the early stuff from the 80s, but those first couple big albums for them, I remember either having them on cassette or getting them on CD or whatever. And then I just kind of stopped listening to them for a while. And I stopped collecting their latter albums. I didn't buy Reinventing the Steel when it came out. I didn't get those couple of them. And then I don't know, 10 years later, I decided to go get that Greatest Hits set because I was like, I'll get that. And it's great. It's just top to bottom, fantastic songs. And that made me want to go out and get the whole catalog, which I did. But you know something? Sometimes when I'm like in the mood to really listen to Pantera, you know what I'll reach for? Because I held on to that. I reach for that Greatest Hits CD because it is top to bottom their best songs all in one nice little platter.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that perfectly segues into my first choice, which is The Police.
All right.
So I have always had, all the Police. I mean, there's not a lot of them, right? There's only five. So it's not like this, we're talking about a big catalog here. And I'm happy I have them. And I do occasionally pull these out and listen to them through and through. But like I said earlier, if you were to say to me, all right, Pete, we're sending you away somewhere and you can only have one Police CD, that's it. And then the choice I was given would be the Every Breath You Take, the Classics collection. I'd probably be okay with that because I found when we did the top 10 songs from the Police show, and this goes against normally what I do. Normally when I do like top 10 songs of bands, they're not filled with all the hits because I find that in a lot of cases, my favorite songs are not the hits, but the deep cuts. But I found with this band, my favorite songs are all those hits. And I just, in doing that exercise, I was like, you know what? I really like this band, but I like their hits the best. They were monster sellers for a reason. And so that compilation I talked about with 14 tracks, I'd be perfectly fine with that. I really like these albums a lot, but if you were to take them away from me and say you can only have this compilation, I'd be okay with it because all my favorite songs are on that compilation.
Yeah, it's a good point. And hits, singles are chosen for a reason. They're often, it's a really magical thing that if you sat down a whole bunch of people and said, pick the best songs and then this is the filler, there's usually a pretty democratic opinion about that. And that's kind of cool. And so, you wonder why bands, if they're really trying hard and if this is a big deal and the stakes are high, why they don't just throw out all the filler and go away and write some more hits when they do that. But the problem is they never do that. They never do that, consumer panel thing beforehand. And if more bands did that, the albums would have been better along the way, right?
Yeah.
Because there's definitely a lot of filler. But yeah, Police, great hits, except for every Breath You Take. I mean, every other song, you
agree with you Roxanne on that one, yes.
And Message in a Bottle. And, they're amazing songs. So yeah. Cool. All right. So my second choice, a band we've talked about recently is this band here, The Tubes.
Yep.
Now I picked this and I will talk about The Tubes differently than the way we talked about it before, because again, there's something about when you get to the later albums for sure. The idea of She's a Beauty, opening track on this one, right? So the idea of the opening track, usually a video track, usually the single track, but that's a clue to hit them as well. Talk to You Later off of this one, right? Great, huge song. And even this album where I don't like a lot of it, Piece by Piece is the opening track on it. And then, so there is this idea of the big, later on, the big commercial stadium rocking songs where it's not particularly funky and it's not a ballad, but it's just a big rock accessible song. Those are my favorite Tube songs from that era. And then when you get to the early stuff, there's the idea of hit singles coming from kind of novelty songs. Like on this one, it's Don't Touch Me There, you know, the smell of burning leather and all that, right? Slip My Disco, a disco theme song, is a big song of theirs as well. And then you look at Now, and on Now it's Smoke, about smoking, right? And then Remote Control's got, I think Primetime was a bit of a big song on this. TV Is King, I really like. I don't think that was much of a single. But when you get to the debut, again, the hit singles are things like Mondo Bondage, a little bit of novelty to that. White Punks on Dope, a lot of novelty to that. So, all the big tube songs are my favorite songs because I do like that injection of humor that you get in those. They're fancier songs. They've just got more flash to them than the non-hits from the tubes. So if you put together a package, it would be kind of those two dualities: opening track, big stadium rock songs, and the novelty songs that kind of got a subject to them or have a little bit of a trendiness, or they're talking about a trend or whatever at the time. So there you go. Tubes, my number four.
Yeah, I think with the tubes, it's like, and I agree with you, their best songs were the hits, but I'd almost feel like if I was given, you know, not given a choice, and I could only have that hits collection, I'd probably start to be missing some of those other deep album cuts. Because I think that's a band that has a lot of variety in their catalog, right? And it's like, you know, their more accessible songs are amazing. But there's some really cool, weird stuff in that catalog that I'd kind of miss if I like didn't have access to it. But yeah, I totally can see that point.
Yeah,
totally can see that point. Cool. All right, my next choice is Bad Company. So, and I'm specifically talking here about the first half of their career, right? I'm not talking about the Brian Howe era. So this is a band, you know, growing up, I had a bunch of their albums on LP, and then, you know, the CD age came, and you know, I eventually sold all my LPs. And I was like, you know, do I replace all those albums on CD? Originally, I decided not to. And I picked up this, really good. It's still really good. The original Bad Company anthology, I think, was released in 99. Two CD set, 33 songs. I mean, you know, Bad Company is a band that had some monster hits. And once you get past, like, you know, Bad Company and Straight Shooter, the rest of these albums are good to somewhat mediocre, with one or two, maybe three hits on it, really good tracks, and the rest of it, not that good. So while, you know, I love having them all, and like I said, there's stuff on these albums beyond the hits that I kind of like, you know, maybe a track or two, there's so much filler on these albums that, you know, the more I look back on it, that anthology really was a great anthology. And if someone were to come to me, it's like, well, you know what, I never really listened to Bad Company, I never collected anything by them, but I like the hits. Should I, you know, which one should I go out and get? I'd probably say first, I'd be like, well, just go get these and you're probably pretty good. But to go beyond that, I'd say, you know what, that two disc anthology, which I used to have, is amazing. And it's got every solid to great song from all of these albums. And that's really all you need. And the more time goes on, I mean, I really like this band a lot, but I mean, they've got a lot of filler in their catalog. It's like, it's almost like they've got every album is like those great songs and then the rest. And the rest is like there are a lot of bands that we've talked about ad nauseum here on the channel that most people know for the hits, but the deep cuts are even better. Bad Company is definitely not one of them, I don't think. So yeah. For me, they're a really good example of what we're talking about here, of a band that's got a good amount of albums, but a really good two-disc compilation, probably the way to go for someone who's kind of on the fence about taking the plunge into their catalog.
Yeah, they're a funny band. They're fighting you liking them a lot because everything is so simple. It's just like a power trio, not a lot of overdubs. The productions are pretty dry and normal and sober. They don't want to put a lot of stuff into what they're doing. They're like a slightly more complicated version of Free, en route to only a slightly more complicated version of later Bad Company matched with Foreigner. You know, there's a little more going on, but even Foreigner is keeps it simple. So You're right. Those big hits, like, you know, the other thing about a hit is that when you hear it on the radio or whatever, you just feel like you're listening to it with a whole bunch of people. And Bad Company's just got these massive celebratory, you know, awesome classic rock songs. And then some of the filler stuff can be a little funky or a little bluesy. I like the very mellow songs that they do. Some of the stuff that they do that's acoustic without drums or whatever, but I totally agree. That's one band where the hits, you know, there's a big gulf as you move on down.
Huge gulf, yeah. Yeah, there's a big gap there.
Yeah. Cool. All right. My number three is I didn't bring out the props, but I've brought out all you need here from Grateful Dead is right there in those two big massive box sets, right? So my thing with the Grateful Dead is I've always been like this. My favorite stuff is the Donna years. I love Shakedown Street and Terrapin Station. So I like it when they've broken it up into shorter songs. And I love that they've parachuted in this female vocalist and there's dual female and male vocalists. Very normal conventional songs. I don't like jammy Grateful Dead or psych Grateful Dead. You know, my favorite Grateful Dead songs easily would have been on the greatest hits. It's Fire on the Mountain, Uncle John's Band, Sugar Magnolia, even Touch of Grey, which everybody puts down, right? You know, the last two albums are considered of a pair. They're a little bit of the late commercial period Grateful Dead. Maybe they sound a little more like Little Feet, I suppose, at that point. A proggy version of Little Feet, maybe. But Friend of the Devil, Casey Jones, Truckin'. So I like my two favorite periods of Grateful Dead are number one, the Donna years, which are very commercial. The late Donna years, very commercial. And then the Exile in Main Street version of Grateful Dead, right? When they're the Americana Grateful Dead, the U2 yeah. Rattle and Hum Grateful Dead, right? Of American Beauty and whatever that Working Man's Dead, right? So those two, the Donna years, and I'm a supporter of the last two records they made, which are you know denigrated somewhat as being just too polished and too commercial or whatever. So yeah, there you go. That's a band like give me a 3.5 minute. Mellow acoustic Grateful Dead song. Give me some Donna on it and I'm happy. I don't need the big long explorations. I don't need the psych.
Yeah, it's funny because you know you talk to like serious deadheads, right? Who love everything they did. They love the experimental spacey stuff, the out there stuff, and obviously we know, you know, all the reasons why, as well as the shorter, more catchy, compact stuff, right? But I think there's so many people out there who are just they have this misconception of what the Grateful Dead are all about. And they think that everything the Dead does are these aimless, lengthy jams. And they're forgetting the fact that this band had a lot of really good, you know, whatever you want to call them, country rock, pop rock songs that are just, you know, really melodic and really memorable that are not necessarily what they think that band is all about.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But yeah, you could.
Yeah, and you know,
I love both aspects of the Dead. So,
I mean, yeah, I mean, the magic moments, the most magical moments, you would need somebody to go through and find them to convince the fan like me. And those would be those magic live ascendant explorations where everything just is magic. But I don't have the patience for that. I don't want that. I don't even really want Jerry on an electric guitar. I don't like that slightly piccolo clarinet, whatever you want to call it, wiry Steve Howe thing that he does. I'm just not a fan of his style. I want him on acoustic guitar more than anything, right? And those beautiful straight, you know, lush productions of the you know Terrapin Station and Shakedown Street.
Yeah,
there you go,
man. Terrapin Station and Shakedown Street, two great albums, really good albums. I actually prefer that stuff to the Working Men's Dead and American Beauty stuff. You know, for me, I think that those two albums, they're great, but they veer a little too far into the countryside of things for me. And I like that kind of when the Dead embrace like prog and funk and pop and soul like they did on those latter 70s albums. But I mean, I like all the stuff. I like the early blues stuff, too. It's a really cool band that if you go through their discography, I mean, they constantly kind of changed and morphed a lot. Whereas a lot of people, like I said, have this pigeonhole look into what the Grateful Dead are all about. They were this just crazy, aimless, meandering jam band throughout their career. You know, really, when you look at the studio stuff, not really. You know, maybe if you go see them live or you buy the millions of live albums, but the studio records are a completely different thing, in my opinion.
Yeah, the pre 70 is a black hole to me, and like 72 through to 75 or 76 or whatever it is, black hole to me. But the rest of it I love.
Yeah. All right, so next up for me, I'm going to talk about Eagles. So, I mean, this is a band that I was listening to really early on. So when I first started enjoying the Eagles music, it was with Hotel California. So that, you know, what was that, 1970, whatever year that was, 75, 76, 77, whatever year it was. And, you know, I bought The Long Run when it came out. Really excited about that. Went back and bought like one of these nights on the border. This has got all the discs. I had all these on LP. And another one of those bands that very spotty catalog. You know, you could make an argument that Hotel California is their absolute gem, start to finish. One of these nights is pretty strong. On the Border is strong. The Long Run's got some really good tracks. I think like there's greatness in this entire catalog, and I'm a fan, so I got to own them all, right? I have all of them. But again, I don't know why I bought it, but like some in the early 2000s, they came out with this, the very best of compilation, two-disc compilation, had the white cover, had the interesting little mask thing on the front, everything like that. Two discs, 33 songs. And again, I think I just kind of bought it as a CD to have to play in the car because the wife likes the Eagles and she likes all the hits and everything like that. And, you know, you listen to that and it's got basically every, for the most part, maybe 90% has all of the strong tracks from all of these albums, all in one nice little set. And I couldn't argue anybody saying, you know what, I don't need this. I'll take that. I couldn't argue it really. I have this because I'm a fan and I want to have all of them, but you know, how often do I go and listen to the first album through and through, or, you know, Desperado through and through, or, you know, even The Long Run through and through? Not that often. And you know, for me, some of their hits are way overplayed. So when I'm in the mood to not hear those big, big tracks, I'll go and listen to some of the deeper cuts. But you know what? Their best songs were the hits. Or even the ones that get played on FM classic rock radio a lot that weren't necessarily hits, but they're staples on rock radio. Those are really good too. But yeah, it's again, I'm a fan, but I would not argue to steer anybody towards a really good two CD compilation of these guys, as opposed to saying, yeah, go out and buy all the albums. Again, it's not a lot of them. We're talking about six here from the classic era, then they put out the later one. But you know, there's greatness on all these albums. Do you need all of them? Yeah, debatable.
Yeah. You know, something we haven't brought up and proof that that's a great pick is that Eagles' Greatest Hits, the original Greatest Hits album, is one of the top selling records of all time by anybody, right? And another band like that is Steve Miller Band. His Greatest Hits album is just a massive, massive seller over above anything, right? So, yes. You know, you could pick out those bands and find the ones where people have voted and said, this is the correct answer. And yes. they voted by just sending the Greatest Hits album through the stratosphere, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Steve Miller is another great choice. Another band that I was really into back when I was a kid and still like them. But for me, it's like, you know, The Joker, Book of Dreams, and Fly Like an Eagle. It's really all you need. Mm-hmm. You know, those are the three huge albums. And that Greatest Hits set that we talked about, you know, the blue cover and the horse on the front, basically all the songs, for the most part, came from those three albums.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny. I was looking at the catalog the other day. I think his first album where he had a breakthrough was like his eighth record or something, right? It's like Pink Floyd with Dark Side of the Moon, right?
Yeah.
All right. My number two choice on this idea of greatest hits is this band right here, Status Quo. Love this band. Have loved them to death my whole life. There's a big stack of Quo records for you there. What's interesting? Rocking all over the world. Pile Driver, that was the first one I ever got. And love the that one. What else you got? Dog at Two Heads. This is my favorite of all of them. Quo.
I love that cover too on that one. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's really cool. What else we got? And then we get into the later one. So the idea with Quo for me is that, and it's a cool thing if you're a headbanger, but really their most famous songs are some of their heaviest songs they ever did, with Down Down and Little Lady and Big Fat Mama and even their Bye Bye Johnny. What else we got? Roll Over, Lay Down, Rain. Caroline's pretty heavy. Paper Plane is kind of poppy, but heavy enough. It's kind of almost like this punky thing off of Pile Driver. And then even later on, when they became the pop version of Status Quo with Rockin' All Over the World and Whatever You Want and In the Army Now and all those songs. Not so much In the Army Now, but the big songs that you get like on this Frantic Four reunion, Backwater, Just Take Me. One of the most famous, you know, it's a dual song kind of thing. That's probably the very top for me. Is There a Better Way? Their most heavy metal song of all time is one of their most famous songs of all time, right? So Blue Eyed Lady's pretty cool. Most of the time is pretty, you know, bopping heavy. Oh Baby is kind of like a doomy boogie thing. 4,500 times as heavy. So it's crazy, but this is one of those bands, and it's in some ways it's a little bit like Nazareth too, I suppose, but the fans, the deep fans of this band are the fans that love them to be as heavy as possible and rocking and up tempo as possible. So all of their big hits are as headbanging as they got. And I swear, like, I think one of the greatest magic rock and roll moments of all time is when they come out of that break in Backwater and go back into the verse again with that back and forth guitar dialogue. It's just one of the most energetic, powerful things. It's based on a boogie, but that doesn't matter, right? And then second and third magic moments of all time are how energetic Down and Little Lady are as well. So yeah, it's when I go over the hits, I just love with this band. So it's a little different situation than all these, that their hits are actually their heaviest songs, but I'm totally happy with that. So Status Quo number two.
Yeah. Status Quo, like, always frustrated me. Like, I have a whole bunch of their albums on scene. They've got a million albums, right? I have a whole bunch of them, and I mean, I dig them. I find their style kind of repetitive and monotonous to me at times. But I agree with you. Their best songs are those hits. They are the heaviest. And quite frankly, like, I almost never pull out any of the Status Quo CDs to listen to. But the one that I do pull out to listen to, which has all of the songs on it, is that early live album.
Yeah. Double Live. Awesome.
And those songs are so even heavier on that album. And for me, it's almost like I could probably ditch all of those albums, those CDs that I have, and just keep that live album, and I'd be completely happy with it.
No, absolutely. Yeah.
That serves like a greatest hits live, basically. So
yeah. Cool. Right on.
All right. So my next band. So I've gotten the three out of the way that I am a big fan of. All right. And I actually have the whole catalogs of. So now I'm going to get into two that I like. But in investigating their music beyond the hits, I've decided I'll stick with my greatest hits set, because what I like from this band, from what I've heard, is what's on that compilation. The first one is The Cars. Okay, so, you know, got this compilation, Just What I Need. The Cars anthology came out in the mid-90s. Two discs, 40 songs. It's got every hit on it. It's got a lot of those deep cuts that I like from the first two albums, which for me are, if I were to go and buy any of their albums beyond the compilations, I would get the first two Cars albums, because for me, those are the best. All right. The rest of the stuff is, you know, they're much more mainstream sounding and less of interest to me. There's some cool rarities on there as well, which is kind of neat. Get some of the deep cuts. For me, The Cars, that's all I need. Even the hits, I don't love. I like some of the early hits, some of the 80s, mainstream stuff is fine for what it is. But, you know, so many people love this band. I mean, love this band. And, you know, Pete, I can't believe you don't like The Cars more than you do. It's like, all right. So I've often tried to investigate their music beyond the hits to see, what am I missing here? And I like the popular stuff and all those deep cuts, all those full albums, not that interested in. So for me, I'm probably never going to go beyond that anthology that I have. And for me, that's good enough. And fine band, and I can see the appeal. And I don't dislike them by any means. And I like a good handful of their songs quite a bit. The others, I'm kind of like, whatever. But that's all I need for The Cars, is that anthology. I'm good with that.
Yeah, just what I needed, right? Yeah, you know, and you're right. I mean, the deep cuts can be a little Devo-ish, a little quirky. You've got that vocalist you got to learn to love, right? They can be a little non-melodic. They could be a little atmospheric, very spare. There's not a lot going on a lot of their songs. And then the production can be a little annoying at times too, right? So that's why the first one really stands apart. It's the most analog out of all of them, right? I think it's Roy Thomas Baker produced it, right? But then, you know, immediately, even on the next album, they start getting really into that, like, you know, keyboards, drum machine, or keyboards and treated drums and a vocal and not much else, right, going on. So it gets pretty simple, but yeah, and they're big. And Candio, what a catchy song off of that one, right? And then most of the first album, but then again, most of the first album was a hit. I mean, that's almost like a Boston, you know, where half the album was played on the radio, right? Well, three quarters of the album was played on the radio.
Yeah, and what happened to those tasty guitars, man, later on? It's like,
yeah.
Yeah, it's like,
exactly. Yeah. All right. My last choice, and my top choice, I don't know. They all had their characteristics of why they're on here, but my last choice is another band I love to death. It's this band right here, Frank Zappa. Mm-hmm. There we go. You are what you is. Is this? No, this is Joe's Garage 2. So I picked Zappa, because when you brought up this concept, I immediately thought of he's got an actual CD called Strictly Commercial, right? And it lays it all down. And you know, you look at that, and again, I like my Zappa funny. I like my Zappa 3.5 minutes long with a vocal and a chorus. And you know, so Dirty Love, San Bernardino, Dancing Fool, Disco Boy is just a tour de force of production. It is so cool. What a great song. So much going on in there. I even loved Valley Girl when it came out, right? And usually the first track on these albums, Joe's Garage, is the most famous song off of Joe's Garage. It's just got this great chorus and verse. It's, you know, it's so hooky, right? Montana. You know, another example of this, these weren't hits, but it's an example of him being very commercial, was when he did that Broadway the Hard Way album, which is all originals and all live, right? I mean, it's quite amazing what he did there. Cosmic Debris, Don't Eat the Yellow Snow, like these are all the songs I want from Frank. You know, forget the Edgar Varese or whatever classical stuff, or the long, you know, elaborate guitar albums. Then you move into the full band stuff that is really jammy and fusion-y. And then you move into the 60s stuff, which I just have no stomach for whatsoever. Like that basically pre about 1973, forget it. I don't care. I mean, my favorite Zappa era is actually his most commercial era, which is sort of that, around 70, what would Joe's Garage 1 be? So 77, 78, yeah, somewhere in there, 79, Chic Your Booty, right? Chic Your Booty. Starting with that mainly, right through to the end of the normal albums, when you get up to A Man from Utopia and Ship Arriving Too Late, where he basically peters out the same way King Crimson just decides, well, I'm off on a tangent for the rest of my career, right? So those records of songs end more or less. So that period is my favorite Zappa period. And, you know, if that makes me a Zappa poser or whatever, call me a poser. But that's what I want. I just want the most commercial stuff Frank's got. And I can listen to that stuff all day long. I listen to tons of Zappa all the time. But it is those albums, especially You Are What You Is, which is just like song after song after song after song for a double album. It's perfect. And like I say, Joe's Garage, Chic Your Booty, all of that kind of stuff. So there you go, Frank Zappa.
And interestingly enough, for me, the period of Frank that I like the most is the one that comes right before where you're talking about. So that whole jazz fusion era.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. So this, cool. You know, we're talking about all those from, like, you know, 71, 72 through about 77. So that's, you know, the band with George Duke and Napoleon Murphy Brock and Ruth Underwood. And I love that stuff. Love that stuff. But again, I think Frank had a very strong jazz sensibility, and he appreciated progressive rock, and he had like some of the wickedest bands right around that time. You know, some just absolutely fantastic albums. But I could totally see. And the funny thing is, when Frank decided to commercialize his music a little bit more, right, and make it more accessible for the masses, I think some of it went completely over a lot of people's heads.
Yeah.
Or did he ruin them so much with that totally not accessible music that people just didn't even bother? I don't know.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
Because the guy was a genius, no matter what he did.
A lot of directions. I you know, and when he always would bring back that old 60s doo-wop thing too. And I hated that stuff, right? I hated it later. I hated it in the middle. And I hated it at the beginning, right? When he actually was in that era, right? But and guitar, I actually went on a long winter walk last night and listened to all of Thing Fish on the whole walk. Like, what a crazy record that is, right?
Yeah.
But it's the fusion stuff, you hear it in his guitar soloing. Like, his guitar soloing is fascinating, right? To me, it almost sounds like a parody of a heavy metal guitar solo and a parody of a fusion guitar solo at the same time. It's like he's putting down these other genres because he's a genre unto himself. He's almost making comedy when he does a guitar solo, I think.
He's one of the
parody in there somehow.
One of the most original sounding guitar players of all time. He would use all these different weird scales and things. And at times, even his tone, like, didn't even sound like a guitar. It almost sounded like a saxophone or a horn or something like that. He definitely, you know, his middle name must have been Unconventional.
Yeah.
Because really nothing he did went by anything that you would think of as like normal song structure, tone, anything, composition. I mean, Frank was a genius, but he was definitely on another plane. From another world. Totally.
My Desert Island Band, absolutely, because you'll never get bored with all that stuff.
No, never.
So much, right? Yeah.
Totally. All right, so my final pick of the day here, this is more an artist as opposed to, it's a band, I guess, but Tom Petty and Company, right? Again, another guy who has been all over the radio since he first came out with that debut album, all right? I mean, that debut album, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and then Damn the Torpedoes. I mean, shit. I mean, every song, for the most part, of those albums were played on the radio. And then this guy had just one massive hit after another all throughout the 80s and into the early 90s. But I never bought any of his individual albums, never owned one of them. For whatever reason, I don't know. I mean, again, they were playing so much of this stuff on the radio, on MTV. It's almost like everywhere you turned, there was Tom Petty in some fashion or form. So I got I think it came out in 2000, Anthology Through the Years. I finally broke down and bought this double disc Tom Petty collection. It's got 34 songs, every single hit you'd ever want to hear. You know, a lot of the early albums are represented, like 80-90% of the albums are on this anthology, some decent deep cuts. But again, you know, this guy's got a lot of albums. So if I was to stop tomorrow and say, all right, I'm going to just go buy all the Tom Petty albums, there's a lot of them. And so many people have said, you really need to get into Tom Petty and all the albums and whatnot. And I've listened to a lot of them and I'm like, yeah, it's okay. But do I really need any of that? Yeah. Right? Or do I have everything that I'll ever need from this guy? And again, not an artist I listen to a lot. You know, I listen to Springsteen a lot more than I do Tom Petty. But again, they're very similar. But I just don't think I will ever need anything beyond that double disc compilation of Tom Petty. It's got, I mean, in listening to most of his albums, trying to decipher if there are gems hidden there that I haven't already gotten on my anthology, I still think what I have is the best. I don't need to go any further.
Yeah. Yeah. He's one of those artists that I say, you know, all of us deep music fans like way too many bands. We got to draw the line somewhere and say, I'm not a fan of some of these bands. And I always put him in there along with Talking Heads. And I try hard to like Patti Smith, and I'm just never a Patti Smith fan. Right. And Tom Petty is so much like that. I mean, I owned all those albums. So on the negative side, I'm not a fan. I don't like that voice. I never like anything to do with pub rock. I don't like a pub rock sound, right? And he's a little bit of a pub rock sound at the same time, that roots Americana mixed with
that whole Americana thing. Yeah.
But the R&B pub rock Southside Johnny, you know, Wilco, whatever, you know, that thing, there's a bit of that in it as well, even though they're from Florida or whatever. But But when those hits do come on the radio, I'm fine. I'm happy hearing those hits. You know, most of them I like. They take you back to another time. They remind you of this great successful era, you know, many eras along the way that he had. And they're good. And there's a variety when you stack all those hits up together. But the deep tracks are just too conventional. I mean, he just wants to be every single player in that band, and every song and every lyric and everything is just so everyman. It's just the whole band is about being ordinary. That's the whole idea of Tom Petty, right? And then, you know, you could say that for Billy Joel, and you could say that in certain ways for Fleetwood Mac or the Eagles or whatever. It's just trying to be the most universal, blah, 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 feeling every man. This is exactly what everybody feels and needs. And this is music that everybody can access, no matter how, you know, unmusical you are or whatever, right? Yeah. So yeah, that just never really been much of a fan, but totally agree. When those hits come on, he does so many different little things that are all showing up in all those hits, even a little bit of heaviness or whatever from time to time, right? Yeah. So I find, yeah, great choice.
And you know, you mentioned his voice, and by all rights, I should hate his voice because I despise Bob Dylan for that voice. I mean, I can't stand, you know, everybody says, oh, but Dylan's the greatest songwriter of all time and so on and so forth. It's like that may be, but as soon as he opens his mouth up to the microphone, I can't listen. I mean, I can't stomach Bob Dylan's voice.
Yeah.
And I mean, Tom's voice is not that far removed, but maybe it's the type of music and maybe, you know, his voice is not quite as jarring for my ears. I don't know. So I don't mind Tom's voice too much. I mean, I can't listen to him obviously for an hour or two straight. I mean, that's the thing. Cause after a while I'm like that kind of whiny kind of, you know, the nasally thing that he's got going on or had going on, I should say, you know, it's not my preference of the type of singer I normally would listen to, but yeah, it was always, especially early on, was hit or miss for me. As I got older, I was able to, all right, I can deal with this singing style because, you know, again, these hits are really good for a reason, but yeah, there's something about, and you know, I'm from the US, so it shouldn't bother me, but there's something about this whole idea of Americana that I never really liked much. But I can stomach it from time to time. You know, I don't mind it too much. This cult like singer songwriter thing, right? Not really my
thing. Yeah, there's that whole can of worms. The idea of what is Midwest rock, right?
Yeah.
Midwest rock. I mean, oh, it's the worst thing in the world to be called Midwest rock because it means ordinary in every way. That's kind of what it's supposed to be, right?
Yes.
So it's weird. It's hard to, and again, this idea of pub rock where there's these roots back to 60s music and pub and R&B and just, you know, I mean, I love Graham Parker to death, but when he's doing, you know, dancey, swingy Graham Parker, forget it, right? But the guy's a legend to me, right? But Springsteen has that. Billy Joel even has it to some extent. Tom Petty has it in spades, and it's pub rock. It's literally what Southside Johnny and those kinds of bands and Mink DeVille and all this came up with. Not a fan.
Yeah. Yeah, but people love it. So, hey, that's fine. You know, that's fine. I need a little something more, you know. To me, it's a lot of that music is very bland and just, like you said, ordinary. And that's okay. There are a lot of people who like their music to sound like that. And that's totally cool. Yeah. Totally cool.
Right on.
So there you have it, guys. 10 bands, artists that, you know, okay to just have the greatest hits, in our opinion. So, yeah. Interested to see what some people's choices would be in the comments below. So if you've got some bands that you kind of dig, but you don't need to go any further than the greatest hit set, put them down in the comments below. And I apologize to everybody for my whining dog outside my door. There's a whole story behind it, and she's going to get in tongue lashing for me as soon as I get out of this call because I've listened to it long enough. So I apologize, everybody, for my husky's constant talking and warbling out there. But anyway, Martin and I are back next Friday for part two of our really cool discussion on perfect album. So we've each got some additional picks for you. The first episode has done extremely well. A lot of people really seem to be into that concept. So we'll be back with some more choices next week. And I think you'll dig this part too. So Martin, I know you got some books almost finished up and come in. You want to just mention a couple real
quick? Yeah, I'm waiting for the sweet one. I called it Rebel Rouser, a Sweet User Manual, because I kind of like that for the Van Halen one, which I called Unchained, a Van Halen User Manual. The Angel book is back in print. And yeah, that's about it. Working on a few other things, but whatever I have in print is available. If there's PayPal buttons there at martinpopoff.com, it means it's available, except for Judas Priest Turbo, which has PayPal buttons. I keep getting these orders and I have to tell them, no, I'm going to have to refund you, or can I give you a 2-for-1 or something like that? But yeah, martinpopoff.com for the books.
Okay, cool. Sounds good. Order up some cool books, everybody. And he's got more coming, so stay tuned. Visit us on the web at www.seeatranquility.org. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter. Of course, we're here on YouTube all the damn time, I should say. Upcoming programming this weekend, Rich Catino coming back on the show on Sunday. We are going to give our top 10 songs of Armored Saint. And then, of course, Monday night, live with the Hudson Valley Squares. We are having a live broadcast Monday night, so we'll be there with the chat room, and you can ask questions, and the topic will be our favorite guest appearances on albums or songs. So stay tuned for that Monday night, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, live. We'll see you all then. For Martin Popoff, I am Pete Pardo. Have a good weekend, everybody.